up, everybody? Welcome to Town Hall Meeting with the Mayor. I am your host, Eugene Man Roberts. And before we get this episode started, I want to just thank you guys for tuning in and being a part and subscribing and liking and sharing with your friends. I know right now a lot of people are at home being creative, and those are the people I like to talk to, and those are the people I want to feature on this show. So spread the word. Like I said, you can be on here. Your people can be on here. Your friends, your favorite artists, your favorite songwriter, everybody. So first up, is my friend, my homeboy. He's a big bro to me. He's a music director, drummer, producer, a man of many talents, great father too. Give it up for my homeboy, Rex Hardy. My bro, Mr. Rex Hardy, what's up, bro? How you, man?
Feeling, bro. Life is, in the midst of everything happening, life is pretty good. I ain't got no complaint.
Yeah, you're a father, so you're like me. So despite all, like, the cool thing is we get to spend time with our families right now. You know, yeah. that's what I really like about. Of course you can't like it. What's going on? But you know what I mean. Like, that's the cool thing. Like, and your kids are younger, so you get to watch them, you know, day in and day out, like growing up and everything. So I'm pretty sure that's like a blessing, right?
Yeah, it's definitely a blessing. I mean, it's like, it's almost like you think about things different now, because by us road or whatever we doing, we kind of miss that window, stuff that we take for granted because we always gone. Then you come back, you be like, wow, I didn't see you, you know, I didn't see you grow up far as now you taller. I've been gone for 3 months. Now I'm in the house with you the entire 3-4 months.
Yeah, so it goes from being away, and it's like you come back and it's like, wow, you're talking, to now it's like the flip side of, like, you see them every day, you actually don't see them getting taller really because you see them every day. So yeah, it's like that flip of the script. Man, I got a question. I haven't asked anybody this question, actually. You've been with Mary how long?
16 years.
16 years. Yeah. So, and I've been with John 16, almost 16 years. My question for you is, what's one of your most memorable experiences with Mary, especially knowing the growth from them when you joined to now? What's like your most memorable moment?
Man, that's a hard one, because there's been a lot. But I will say probably playing at the White House. I would say playing at the White House for sure. Y'all did one too, right?
Yeah, we did. We probably did everything y'all did.
So that was pretty like mind blowing, just for the fact of when we got on her gig 16 years ago, we weren't thinking about no black president,
right?
So then to be with an artist that the president, first of all, he's from here. He's from Chicago.
Right.
And then
that's like hometown hero to the 10th power.
Oh, definitely to the 10th power. But so to be playing for him and his wife with one of their favorite artists, and I happen to be this favorite artist's music director, it was crazy. It was
so as far as a music director, how did you approach it mentally, knowing, like, because of course, like, I know a lot of us know you play multiple instruments. We know that, you know, if you had to teach a keyboard player their part, you going to at least pick them notes out in them chords and tell them it's right and wrong. So how did you approach that coming from the drum throne and now in this position where it's like you're doing these arenas and you're doing these TV shows and, like, you know, like, it's flawless. Like, you guys always sound amazing. Like, we know it ain't much in the track. We know, like, you know, that whole thing. What was your approach mentally?
For me, I just kind of took everything that I learned from, for one, from musicians that was around me, but two, drummers that happened to have been music directors on their gigs. Uh-huh. Even came up. Like, when Teddy was, he was the music director of Britney Spears when she was at her peak, you know, Nissan Stewart. So those guys, I kind of saw how they moved. And one thing about them, they always moved with people they knew they didn't have to tell a lot to. You feel me? So if I got there, I know he's kind of going to know what I'm thinking already. Yep. So I try to get people who play their instrument like I play it.
Yeah. So that way you don't have to overwork and overthink. Yeah. Because, I mean, I think a lot of people, especially with just a musician background, a lot of people don't really understand music director doesn't mean music teacher. Like, my job isn't to teach you the right. format of the song. Like, you know what I'm saying? My job is to make sure you understand what the changes are and make sure we as a unit make sense.
Definitely.
And coming from that standpoint, I think, you know, because I don't know if you know this or not, but, you know, I started as a drummer, you know, and I started with John as the drum tech and stage manager, you know, so I was Swiss Chris's drum tech, like, you know what I'm saying? But I always played drums, so, like, I always just had the mentality of, like, okay, we need to make the music change. We can't keep looping these 16 bars. Like, where's the change, you know? So then it was like, well, what do you think? It's like, all right, cool. So now I got to start learning what those notes are, or knowing, like, going to the 5, going to the 4, or, like, whatever those things were. And then, you know, I just kind of started growing into it, playing and programming. But I think, you know, you're one of those people that are a staple in the industry because you bring what you bring to the table, not only as a drummer, but with the mentality of a music director. It's kind of like a Rashid, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's why it's easy to work with Rashid, because, you know, he MDs Jill. Like, he gets it, you know? There's not much talk. We don't have to go back and forth like, yo, bro, you sure you got the verse? You sure you know how long the verse is? Blah, blah, blah. And it's just like, he's telling me, like, yo, we out. I'm like, thank you, because I ain't had time to learn all of this because I'm worrying about this. Like, you know, and it's always good to have that Batman Robin feel, like, with, especially, yeah, like, as the music director and, like, those people in your band, which is pretty dope, man. So from then to now, so now what's your thing that you feel like you're in? Because right now we all are doing something different. Me, I didn't start learning video editing and, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, we become these other people.
It's funny because you know me. So I always try to stay ahead of the curve. Like, I always try to figure out not necessarily what's next, but what can I learn that'll further me out being just a drummer, you know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Like, even back in the day, like, I used to have I still got the YouTube channel, but I used to put up, like, crazy videos of us rehearsing with Mary, and I would edit it all myself. Mm-hmm. But really, stuff started picking up. Like, I got married, my kids came, all that ceased. Like, it was just...
Yeah, I ain't got time for that. My extracurricular is being dad.
Days was over. But now, I find myself digging back into video editing. I've always been a fan of it, but I didn't have time. You know what I'm saying? So I'm doing it, like, I'm doing video editing for my church. I do all
the same here.
Yeah, I do all the pre-records. I do, you know, so it's like, for me, it has nothing to do with music right now. Like, it's, you know, that's in us. But I was like, okay, what else do you have to offer this industry? Because what you normally do ain't needed right now. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So, and you doing something that a lot of people wouldn't normally do, but you're doing it because you got the time and you care. But you've been doing some collaboration videos I've been seeing.
Oh, yeah. Who the I know I did one with Javad. I did
You did the one with Mr. Talkbox, right?
Yep, Mr. Talkbox. He did a LMA and Mary J. mashup.
Yeah, that was hard.
Yeah, he hit me like, yo, man, you know you got to get on this. I was like, all right. Cause
I'm
like, cool. That's nothing. And then, of course, Dana Hawkins played bass on this Fave joint Javad did. Man,
me and Dana honestly met when we were 14 years old as drummers. I'll never forget it. He was in Baltimore in the church, little church I used to play for in Philly. I was playing drums. I came down there to his church. And I forget, we did John P. Key Clap Your Hands. I'll never forget it. And like, you know, that's the dun, 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 so you start, I started doing all these syncopated things back then, and he was just like, yo man, the way you flip the 16th note over the move. I was like, hold up, bro.
I just play.
I just play the drums, man. I all right, little Dennis, I get it. Shout out to Dana Hawkins, man. But like, that's how we met, man. And it was amazing, like, that we're all still friends. And and I think even through this, man, I tell people all the time, and it's my common thread through all of my episodes, that right now is the best time that you can communicate and build relationships, rebuild relationships. Some people are actually screwing relationships up by just not communicating, but then there's that. Yeah. So how important, let's talk about relationships, bro, like far as in the industry and just life and how important they are.
I think relationships is everything, because to be honest with you, your relationship, I mean, just realistically, your relationship is going to last, if it's real, whether you broke or whether you rich.
Yep.
Or whether you just maintain it. But the relationship, if it's not based off one of those, then you always good. You know what I'm saying? Yep. So it's like, I don't get into the, you know, I got a relationship with this dude because he's working, or, oh yeah, that's
yeah,
my.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like, nah, man. It don't matter what the person is doing. Either the relationship is genuine or it's not. But like you said, now people don't have the excuse like, oh no, bro, like I ain't even get your call. It's like, what were you doing?
What were you? You weren't on the plane. You weren't in cell chat. You weren't in rehearsal.
Yeah, so it's like, then you kind of know, like, I got it. They don't really, you know, and it's cool. We grown men. It don't matter. But
yeah, I'm not going to fight to be your friend.
No, nah, it's not that serious. But, you know, like you said, this has shown some of the good in people and some of the bad. So,
yeah,
I just want people to keep that exact same energy once this lift, whenever that is.
If you over there, stay over there. Absolutely. All right. So we know you done toured a lot of people. You the MD. You done this whole thing. Two-part question before we wrap this up. One. Who's your favorite artist that you've worked for? Because again, I love John. That's always gonna be my That's home. That is the majority of who I am and what I've done. But I really enjoyed working with other people and other. You know what I'm saying? Or maybe not your favorite. Like, you know.
I would say working, like when I got the Chaka Khan gig. I was just, and rest in peace to Cornell. That's who.
Yeah. Rest in peace, Cornell. Yep.
Played with Mary. Chaka opened for Mary, in London.
Yep.
Time. So once, you know, we was done with Mary for that time being, you know, they got Cornell, and then it was like learning Chaka's music. The first couple of shows, I wasn't good. It's not that I didn't sound good. My feel wasn't what her music called for.
Yeah, I mean, because you coming from R&B, hip-hop.
For real.
He said, listen, you gonna get all this, Rex.
Look, I was like, I had to, like, because I'm still in Mary tour mode.
Now. Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Playing Feel For You. You know what I'm saying? Songs like that. It's like, tell me something.
You was playing them like you was at open mic?
Basically.
You playing the idea of the music?
Definitely the idea. Kick patterns was probably wrong, whatever, but that taught me to, like, okay, now you gotta disregard Mary and your that approach and now do this. And once I learned it, man, it was so Chaka Khan for sure.
Yeah, I mean, that's an amazing learning moment as well, just for your career, because a lot of people can't do that, go from gig to gig to gig. Like, I had to learn that early, because when I was jumping from John to Snoop, then to Ye, and then you know, it's just like, you're these different people. I'm playing key bass on this gig, then I'm playing talk box and vocoder on that gig, and then I'm playing like main keys on that gig, then I'm literally playing aux on that gig. So I had to kind of start divvying up my mind of how this works.
And they want
all right, so the part two of that, go ahead. What you about to say?
They want all of you, no matter which version of you it is.
Yeah.
And if you're doing aux, they want 100% of that. You're doing key bass, you know what I'm saying? So,
yep.
Yeah, I learned that on Idol, but I mean, I got that start with Chuck because I was born to play Barry's music. That's not even,
right.
I think it's by coincidence that I got the gig.
You know? I think a lot of us that have lasted on certain gigs a long time, it's like we were meant to be there because, you know, we've lasted through a lot of transitions of managements and labels and, you know, budgets and these things that, you know, a lot of people don't know exist outside of seeing us on stage and you know, that whole thing. Yeah. Who's somebody that you, dead or alive, this is like that, I'll take that gig tomorrow, right now. I don't even know the music. You can count me in.
That would be the Temptations. No joke.
Really?
Most people, of course, like my wife, that is my favorite group ever. I can play
back. So you know the movie In and Out.
Oh, absolutely. But the funny thing about the movie is everything they talked about in the movie, I already knew.
Right, right, right.
That's like, I mean, I got videotapes of like just Motown period, but really the Temptations. Like, it's weird. Like, we did Motown Week on Idol one year.
Uh-huh. You was in heaven.
That was the happiest I've been.
You were probably telling them like, nah, my man, that ain't how that go. Cause I got this.
I was doing, bro.
You turned into Questlove real quick, boy. Quest good for that. He know, listen, play some James Brown around Quest.
Dog, first of all, he's a human music historian.
Yeah.
To say
bro, I did Roots Picnic Public Enemy with him. I did Roots Picnic Usher, and I did Roots Picnic Snoop with him. And then I did like a couple regular Roots gigs, like filling in for Poiser and them. And it was just like, yo, this dude is a genius.
Oh.
Like he can play, talk, listen to another song all at the same time. And, you know, he really helped between him and Adam. Like, they put you in the fire so fast that you don't even know what's going on, that you ain't got no choice but to come out successful. Like, because that's a school in itself, and a lot of people don't understand, man. Like, we go through the trenches, like, even now, like, when we get called for certain things, because by the end of the day, we gotta step up and do what we gotta do.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, of course, he's a problem, man. He's a real problem, man.
That's wild. Again, people, this is my big bro, my big homie. We done been in it, so we can talk for hours. We ain't going to do that to you, but we're going to wrap it up soon. But before we wrap it up, bro, like, tell the people something that's just straight from Rex to them. Like, what's going on right now? What you want to see people doing by the time this is all over? Like, any of that?
Me, man, because that's what I'm doing. I want people to take all the good that they learned about themselves from this COVID thing and create that into the rest of your life. Cause we all,
so basically don't stop when this is over, to keep it going.
Yeah. Like, just like we said, keep that other energy going. If your energy positive, don't keep it going. Like, don't start getting, you know, back arrogant or nothing. Cause now you back out in the streets. It's like, nah, if you was cool and humble when you was locked up, that same energy. And you know what I'm saying? I think it'll help all of us get to the next level for the most part. But that's what I'm
so basically what he's saying is stay with it. The long short, stay with it.
Keep that energy. But that's it, man. Yeah.
Well, before we get out of here, I haven't done this with anybody either. Talk about your electronics and in the change of music over the years, of how you transitioned from like barely any to now, like there's no drums in the record, in the track at all when y'all play.
Right. For me as a drummer, like I said, I always tried to stay ahead of the curve. So like real quick, like even when I got with Mary, I had pads shipped out there. She had a percussion player. So on her first gig, her previous drummer, he didn't play electronics to that extent with her because he didn't have to. It was a percussion player. Right. So I was there, you know, I didn't play any percussion. I let, you know, any triggers, whatever.
Yeah, you let him live.
Yeah, so once I moved around, like you said, we get to now, I already knew what was coming.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I already had the equipment, and but now it's just to the point, if you can't really play electronics, I don't really know what gig, you know what I'm saying, you looking to do. Unless it's your own gig, which is cool. But
exactly.
Yeah, it's just a matter for me, it just switched because I've always, it's a switch I turn on and off because I always listen to the music in its entirety.
Yep.
So it's like, okay, that's not a real kick. I need that kick sound, or let me make it. You know what I'm saying? So you're as authentic to the music as you could be. So,
well, yeah, I mean, again, you know, you got those people that think they hear a clap and they just put on any clap.
Anyone. It's like, no, just because it sounds like an 808 clap doesn't mean it's any 8. Like, get them to sample it.
I think, you know, you've worked with artists that are actual producers too. So I think that kind of changes and molds you a different way. My pivotal moment of making sure I had to make sure patches and everything were really right and inversions of chords and stuff, boy, that was when I was playing with Teddy, Guy in Blackstreet, bro. You can't cut no corners with Teddy Riley.
Yeah. Teddy's the dude. I done heard stories. Like, I would work indirectly with Teddy, but I never played for them.
Mm-hmm.
I would play for them for free at some point too, just to say I played the music. You know,
you hear that, Teddy?
Dude, though, they smash. But yeah.
Man, I'll never forget. We was at I guess I can say this because it's over. We were at D Wade and Gabrielle Union's wedding reception, and Guy performed, and Quest was the DJ. So we're in sound check. So we signed these NDAs and nobody can't know who else is there and blah, 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 blah. So we get there to sound check and we all looking at each other like, y'all performing? Y'all performing? Y'all performing? Like, we all looking at each other. So then after we sound check, mind you, it was just me and a drummer playing with Guy because they wanted to keep it as tight as possible. It was a small venue. So I'm playing key bass. I put mostly everything in the track. I was like, I get to play key bass for Guy? Are you kidding me? Groove me? I like... What? You couldn't tell me nothing. So then we got done sound check, and the most historic thing happened right in front of my eyes. Teddy and Quest, I feel like they had just met for the first time, and they started having a conversation about what Teddy used on Remember the Time in the studio.
Wow.
Equipment-wise. So that conversation, like, I've heard the stories, but knowing Quest as a historian, and seeing his eyes like, you know what I'm saying? Like, that was, it's like those memories to me. It's not even like the on stage is cool, but it's like those things are like, man, nobody else would have experienced it.
Oh, yeah. No, it's crazy. When Quincy Jones, I played at the Clive Davis party with Ricky Minor. Uh-huh. When Quincy Jones, I ran into him on the way out. He was like, man, you was the drummer? I was like, yeah. He was like, yeah, you my kind of drummer. Man, I didn't have to play another gig after that, ever.
Yeah, exactly.
Nothing. Kind of. Quentin Jones, bro? Like, come on, yep. Man. It just, you're right. Those are the kind of moments you just be like, okay, yeah, I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing.
Yeah, I mean, because at that point, it's just like, whoever's online that doesn't like Rex Hardy as a drummer, that's fine. Quincy Jones loves my playing. You know what I'm saying? It's like those things, like.
It does not matter. That one, yep. That one compliment can make every negative, you know, whatever people got to say. You'd be like, yeah, all right. Well, Quincy doesn't feel that way. So,
right. Hey, that's like a subtle flex. Like,
right.
No, it's kind of crazy that you really don't like the way I, you know what I'm saying?
Just throw it out there and pull it back real quick.
Yeah. Well, man, before we get out of here, Rex, thank you, my bro, for being a part, man, coming on here, talking to the people, man. Thank you for your contributions to music, being one of the leading MDs, especially, like, not even just as a drummer, but just a MD that facilitates a well-known historic artist of our time. Like, she's one of the greatest of all, like, you know what I mean? And you've been doing it consistently. I've never been to a show, and remember, we was out, and I was with Ro opening for y'all, and it was just, to me, it's amazing to be able to not play with the headliner and play with the opener. I can do my little 20 minutes, and I get to say, wow. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's cool to me. You know what I'm saying? And just, like, thank you for always being a big homie to me and big bro and, like, making sure we communicate and we do what we do, man, for real.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it's all love, man. It goes beyond this music. And that's how I live. It has to. Because if the music won't fade, but if your relationship fades in the midst of you trying to focus on it, it don't really matter anyway.
It's a wrap.
Yeah. But no, man, it's all love here. You know, we brothers.
Yeah, my bro. Well, we about to get out of here, people. Rex Hardy, Man Man Philly, we are out of here.
Rex Hardy, the one and only. I love him, man. We have an amazing relationship. He's always been a big bro to me and always treated me kind. And whenever I need anything, I'm a call away. He's a call away. We're a call away for each other. Next up is my bro. We got a chance to tour together with John Legend for the last few years. Amazing bass player, producer. We've had some music actually coming out together that we've been working on back and forth. So give it up for the one and only Kaveh Rastegar.
Kaveh, what are you doing, man? What's going on? Good to see you, man.
Yeah, man. It's great to see you too. It's great to hear from you and seeing that you're doing this, because you know we're all adapting and making good stuff.
Yeah, what you been up to?
I've been doing I've been doing a lot, man. I've been out on the road. I've been doing gigs. I've been gigging every night. No.
yeah. 6 months ago. No.
Yeah, exactly. yeah, it's like, you know, it's been a trip. Like, everything stopped. I was out on the road with Sting, and we just
shout out to that. How was that? How was it to get that call?
Oh man, it was one of those things, one of those dreams, you know. It's like, you know, been listening to him since I was a little kid, and he's a bass player, you know, and he's to play.
What's your ultimate gig like that? Hey, if I could, this is my most iconic, I would love to.
Oh, let's put me on the spot, man. Iconic gig would be, I mean, probably stuff you've already done, like getting to play with Stevie, you know, getting to sit in with Stevie Wonder, getting to play a song with Stevie Wonder. That's an iconic gig for me. Getting to getting to, I got to meet Paul McCartney one time and maybe getting to play with him, you know, like people like that, people that, but at the same time, yeah, I mean, Sting's, that's just one of them, man. Like, that's just, he's the best. And, you know, talking about bass and stuff like that, every night he would sit down by me. Yeah. And we talk about, you know, he told me some Jocko stories, you know, like they knew each other back in the day. So I was working with him, and when this whole thing happened, it's just, you know, and there was that. And then there was a lot of stuff that you and I had planned, and you know, how it goes, you know, and when everything stops like that, you got to just kind of like circle the wagons, you know, and for me, I live in LA. I went right back to LA, and I'm a father, as you are. And so a big part of my job, because my girls are young, 7 and 9, big part of my week has been educating them, you know, picking up the slack with their teachers. And their mom is a teacher, and she and I split up, but we're working together. Co-parenting. So, but she's a teacher, so she's got to teach during the week. So I teach the kids during the week. You get that time working on all that stuff. So it's really valuable time that you get to spend, you know, with your kids. And then when
I always tell people, this is like a fast forward in life, whereas like you get a preview of what life can be in like 5-10 years. Or like my thought was always like, how can I make money at home so I can stay home and not go on the road? You know, like that whole thought process. And this is kind of like you're forced into it. So now when we go back to our normal things, now it's just like, okay, you keep this going and you do that.
Yeah.
I think you know, that's my.
Yeah, no, I hear you. Like, you know, I mean, like you said, you're sharpening a lot of skills that are valuable. And it's like, until you're faced with the reality of it, you might not make that move to just kind of invest your time to work on, you know, learning that new program or doing the video editing, like you said, or whatever else that you're working on. And the same, so the same goes with me. And I see that with musicians all over. We see that where, you know, I've got a studio that I work out of, and my reality has been, you know, during this quarantine, it has been, like I said, working with my girls, educating them. But when I'm not with them, throughout the week, sessions kind of pile up for me. And so when I don't have them, I've just been spending days getting songs out for different artists and different producers, and
some of the people you work with, if you can say,
well, you know how it is, like with the production projects, you can't always talk about them. But yeah, there's, I mean, it's all across the board, man. Like there's some stuff. A really cool one recently has been able to work with the great producer and great songwriter, Butch Walker. He's worked with everybody, you know, Taylor Swift, and, you know, there's all types of people, and he's doing a couple, I think I can talk about this. There's a few songs, for the artist Matt Nathanson that we've been doing. And it's been a lot of upright that I've been doing sessions for, because a lot of producers play electric bass. So it's one of those things where it's like, you know, it's been nice having that, you know, having the ability to record double bass, have a couple mics set up, bow.
I was saying that about just musicians overall. Like, you know, we always talk about how we met, like just our love for gear and owning gear, and just like, there's nothing like having your own, especially like now. Just think about it. There's some people that's like, oh man, I wish I could shed right now. Why can't you? Oh man, you know, I can't get in the studio right now, or I can't, you know, how many artists can't put themselves, you know?
I know. And there's some artists I'm working with right now that, you know, they're world-class singers and world-class, like people that, you know, you know about, everyone knows about, that are all of a sudden, they're just like, you know, they're in their house in Atlanta, or they're in their apartment in New York or whatever. And they always, worked with an engineer. And, you know, so like all of a sudden it's like there's a record project I'm working on right now where the label is sending the artist a mic, you know, Pro Tools setup, a tutorial. And there's two songs I have on the record that I'm like, I don't want my song to be the one that she kind of learns Pro Tools on. You know what I mean? Like, you know, it's like, you know, you want it to be like the third or fourth once she understands, you know, editing, and she can kind of like let loose and really comfortably sing or whatever. So
going like, this is not the best we got. You know what you're supposed to do.
Yeah. Yeah. And then also, you know, what's a trip? I mean, it's like, I was talking to a buddy of mine. He's Mike Valerio. He's one of the, for those of you, a lot of people don't know who he is, but everyone's heard him. He's played on every movie that's come out since 2000, like all the John Williams movies, Star Wars movies, whatever. He's like the bass player out here. We always talk shit about everything. We're talking about, you know, like all the noise that's getting into everybody's recordings, you know, like all these recordings that have come out during this time. Like 10 years ago, it was all about Beat Detective and about, like, you know, just making everything like on the grid and everything. But now it's all about hearing that gardener outside or hearing the birds. You know, that's going to be making all those tracks, which it's like, unless
I'll make.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but yeah, that's what life's been, man. Like, it's just been like my kids and just kind of like everything slows down, but it's been really meaningful at the same time. It's like, it's this weird antsy kind of thing where you're just forced to look at yourself in the mirror and just be like, all right, this is what we got. This is what we have. These are the tools I have to work with to, you know, make it work, you know?
This is a question I like to ask people.
Yeah.
What's the funniest story? What's the funniest thing that has happened to you on stage?
Oh, man. Oh, boy. Man, there's so many, and I love those stories, you know? I love the... I mean, you and I have had some, and, you know, right now, I'm like, you know, I'm not going to, you know, say anything, but you and I had a good one. I'm just going to say kids, Italy. I'm just going to say those two words, and you know what I'm talking about.
Bro, we just texted about the other day.
Yeah, I know. But, yeah, a good one. What's a good one for me? I mean, I love train wreck stories. I don't love them when they're happening, but I love train wreck stories. And, you know, a good one for me was I used to play in this Italian band. You've heard me talk about him all the time. His name's Luciano Ligabue. He's like the biggest singer in Italy. Yeah, Ligabue. And we had a gig in Sicily where we were playing in this stadium, a soccer stadium. And we were downstairs in the dressing room of the stadium, like getting ready, guitar players like primping their hair, everybody's getting their monitors in, everybody's making sure they look good, you know. Then everybody runs, they do the big huddle, you know, here we go, you know. And usually there's two cars leading, you know, everybody out around the stadium into the track of the stadium. Everybody gets out and boom, it's like time to hit the stage running, like crazy crowds, like fully sold out. And, you know, big screen, you know, behind us, like filming us going on stage, you know, that whole treatment, like the big dramatic thing. And we're downstairs underneath the stage and there's usually two cars taking the band all the way around, you know, boom, you know, to the thing. They're like the two sponsor cars, whatever it was for the tour. And we do the thing, it's time to hit the stage and you hear the crowd going crazy upstairs. Like it's ready because the announcement's already happened and we got to get in these cars. So we open the door to the garage and there's one car, you know? It's like, there's supposed to be two cars. There's just one car. And it was just like, oh shit, you know? Like, and then this one guy's like, you know, oh, you know, talking, you know, the bodyguard of Luciano is just like, oh, Valerio, dove sei? Where are you? You know, dove cazzo sei? Where the fuck are you? You know, like, pardon my French. And anyhow, everybody, finally, Luciano, the singer, is just like, everybody, get in the car, you know? Because it's like, you know, it's about to happen, man. We got to get on stage. And so driver gets in the front, you know, the bodyguard, the artist, the MD gets in the front seat with the artist, like, jumps on his lap. It was like this, like, weird kind of, like, you know, like clown car. All of a sudden, it's like, you know, fucking, you know, like clown car. And then prima donna guitar player one gets in, boom, you know, space for days. Prima donna guitar player two gets in, no problem. Other keyboard player gets in, no problem. And then there's the two Americans in the band, Michael Urbano, great drummer, and me, the rhythm section. And me, I'm 6'6". I'm a freaking giant.
Right.
And there's no space in this car except for in the trunk of the car, like in the hatchback of the car. And it's like, we're like, are you kidding me? Like, are you freaking, really? You know, and we're like, okay. So we like just get in there, like our knees are up to our chins. We're like getting the, like, what's that?
Yeah, you got to do what you got to do.
Yeah, got to do. So we like hop in the car and then the car just goes racing around the stadium. We're racing around the stadium. We all have our in-ears in and we're like, get on the thing. We're just like going like 80 miles per hour around the stadium. We get in, like, we stop. I remember like staring right at Michael. We're just like, oh shit. You know, we got to get it. And you hear the car doors open, then close. And we're going, guys. And like nothing. They freaking leave us in the car. Like the drummer and the bass player, like we're locked in the trunk of the car and they're just running to the stage, you know, and, you know, whatever. And then I just crawl out and like,
wreck.
What's that?
It had to be a train wreck,
dude. And there's a video of it too. It's like a gig in like 2010 in Palermo at the stadium, and you can see like the crowd just.
Well, if we find this video, he's gonna send me this link.
I'll send it to you. Yeah,
show the people what, you know, what y'all was doing, man.
And that's what I love, man. Like that's what we do. It's like, there's so many things that could go wrong in a show. And part of what most people don't know is that everyone's so dedicated to what they do that they're able to, you know, shift and move and boom, you know, like make things work and make it look like it's not a big deal. And I've seen it 1,000 times with shows with us and with John, where it's like, you know, oh, you know, like.
Yeah, no, it is.
Yeah, like, you know, whatever happened, or like somebody misses a step or whatever, or like something happens and to the audience, it's just like another great show. And that's what's amazing. But when it all falls apart, that's the funniest thing in the world.
Yeah. It's just like, no. You know what? All right. You just got to let it rot. One of my stories was, with John, we were, you know, when you're on tour, the first like 8 songs never change. So you're just like, you memorize that. Like, as learning the show, you know, you memorize at least the first half of the show, at least the first. And out of nowhere, we had like a random 45-minute set opening for Stevie. And it was just like, we literally changed the 3rd song in the set. So I'm like, play. Next song, play. Next song, play. He looks at me like, no. I said, man, we already in it now, baby. Oh. I wasn't gonna stop. Oh, it was Get Lifted. Like, we was in Get Lifted. Like, we were like, play the intro and stop. All right, guys. On to the next. Like, it was just, it.
God. And then he runs to the front of stage, just like, okay, you know, no.
I was stressed out. We laughed it off. The heat of it, it was just like, because he's looking at me like, no, I'm like, yeah. You know how you know you, right? I was just like, yeah.
Yeah.
I was like,
that shit's funny, man. It's funny. Or, People falling is always really funny to me. You know, I remember playing.
Remember when we was in LA and we did that thing?
Yo!
Game, no, and the lights went out, bro.
Yeah. And we had to stay still, and I got my base, and I was just like, oh no, like I got to help this guy up. And then, like, the, you know, everything's honest. This guy's like face down right in front of me.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Yo.
Or,
what's up you want to tell, like, some, like, I won't say young up and coming, because at this point, people at all ages are doing everything. So what's a piece of advice or like a hope that you have for people like right now, just in life?
Oh man, that's a good question. I think, you know, right now during this pandemic and this strange time where the business is, everything's up in the air. It's like, you know, it's upside down. Everything's crazy. You know, I mean, I'd say my biggest, like the biggest thing that I wish for everybody I care about and everybody that's doing something is just to have like a little victory in life, a small victory in life, you know, and that could be, you know, so for musicians, it could be like, you know, if you're starting off as a musician and you're just getting started on the bass, and, you know, that little victory could be, you know, finally learning that bass line that you just always wanted to learn, or that thing that got you to actually
made you want to pick up a bass.
And like, let's say you're a kid that's starting out, or you're like a grown man in his 40s or 50s, and you're like, I always wanted to pick up the bass. Boom, and you finally do it. I mean, that's what I wish for my friends, my family, my little cousin, you know, like everybody that's like, you know, because those victories, they lead to everything else. Like, I can trace back anything that's ever happened that was good to me to those first little things where it was like, you know,
yeah,
you show yourself that you can do it. And now in this climate where, you know, we don't have the ability to go and, you know, play gigs or get together and just play with other musicians, you know, it can seem really like abstract, like there's no, you know, kind of, there's no bottom to it. But I would just say, like, keep writing those goals and keep those goals together where it's like, you know, it's one of those things where I've never been through a pandemic, and neither has anyone living on this planet. You know, so no one knows exactly how this is going to go, but I have a good feeling that we're going to get back. It's going to get back and get going again. And all of a sudden, you know, the phone's going to fill up with calls and texts and, you know, and opportunities to work and all that other stuff, whether it be in music or whatever you got going in your life. And this kind of unique time where you just have nothing but time is never going to happen again. And that's the hard part about right now, where it's like some people might be worrying about like chaos in their lives and how to, you know, make ends meet or whatever it is, if it's family stuff or drama or whatever. But if we can try to make it, take advantage of this time to just do, like, to sharpen one skill, like you said, like you're shedding on certain aspects of gear. With me, man, I've been listening to records that people have been talking about for years. Like, you know how you got that thing where, like, you know, somebody always talks about that classic album and it's just like, you're almost afraid to admit it. Like, yo, I never even heard so-and-so.
You go back and now you know it. And now you understand why they had a greater love for it.
Yeah. You got that time now to do that. So that for me is like, I mean, it's simple, but just if you can, but at the same time, don't kill yourself over not using all the time to its greatest potential, because again,
everybody's lives are different. You know, you got to teach. Yeah. I'm helping my kid with, you know, college stuff right now. You know, he's,
yes,
you
know, sir.
Digital graduation, you know, like different things like that. So
yeah.
It's just,
wow.
You know, it's all good, but you know, we just hope for the best.
Congratulations, Chris.
Right. Congratulations to my son, Chris, CO1 Music. We about to talk about that in a minute, too. Yeah. But outside of that, I'm enjoying, like, being able to communicate with people and, like, still, like, you know, being able to have cool stories, though. I think that's the cool thing. A lot of people are getting on, like, Zoom, We gotta do a. We're gonna do a Zoom when we get out. Like later tonight, we'll do a Zoom and we'll get like 15 of us on there. Those are always fun. Like I used to be like, why are people doing that? And then it's like I got on a couple of my family and it was really fun because everybody's talking to each other. But pretty cool. I just want everybody to continue to love and happiness once all this is over. That's all. That's all. That's the only thing.
For sure, for sure. And thank God for the technology that we have. Like, if this had happened 20 years ago, doing the sessions that I'm doing all of this, like communicating with people, feeling less lonely, all that stuff. Thank God for that, you know?
But, man, everybody, we could talk for hours just because it's my brother. We didn't literally travel the world together more than once.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
He's going to share some of his music. He's going to be on here some more. You might see a little collaboration video with us on some music. You never know. I ain't telling y'all, but we are, but we might not. Well, we definitely are, but we probably are going to. But anyway.
You never know.
Right, you know, literally my big homie because he's 6'6", my brother, one of my favorite Kaveh Rastegar. Thank you, brother. Thank you so much,
man. Hey, man, thank you so much for having me, and thanks to Roland, your audience, for hanging with us.
Yes.
Spend your money till you're broke. You don't know what to do with the day till the day grows old. Don't know how to love your woman till she goes. And you can't see the fire through the smoke. Say you gotta stay away to live these dreams. But my life's in much better shape when I'm asleep, it seems. Staring at the answers, but I don't know what they mean. I couldn't see the forest through these trees. And if I had the words to say to make you stay, I'd spit them out. I'm as silent as my grave, this grave I should be digging out. While you're walking down the street, I
And now, a moment to check in on our people being creative at home. Hashtag rolling at home.
Public enemy number one.
Shout out to Kaveh. Shout out to Rex Hardy. Shout out to Roland. Shout out to Roland Live Studios. And you know what? Shout out to my homeboy Joel, because he's the one doing all the cool editing and stuff too. And Nelly and Kristen and Brian. Shout out to Roland again. All my people. I am your host, Eugene Man Man Roberts, aka The Mayor, and this was another episode of Town Hall Meeting with the Mayor. Until the next time.